Hi everyone, it's Motsi. This is to let you know that Hainai is taking a short break while I travel to the Philippines this month. We'll be out from now until the end of May, and we'll be coming back to our regularly scheduled program on June 2. That doesn't mean you won't be hearing from us or getting new content, however. On May 19, you'll all be treated to an excerpt from our brand new bonus episode, remind me to tell you later, Pandango, in which Mary talks about her favorite traditional Filipino dance, which she performed as a child, Pandango sa Ilaw, where dancers perform with lit candles, in some parts balance on their heads. You can enjoy a short excerpt of that episode on our main public feed on Acast, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and wherever you listen to podcasts. You can also enjoy the full episode and all our other bonus episodes by subscribing to the $10 at that tier on our Patreon. The support would mean the world to us, and it's needed now more than ever, while I deal with the difficulty of almost a full year of unemployment. And for those who don't follow our socials, on May 25, I will be doing a free live reading at the Salaysay Filipino, Filipina, and Filipinx Literary Festival, happening at the Barbara Frum branch of the Toronto Public Library from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. That's the Barbara Frum branch on 20 Covington Road, Toronto, near Bathurst and Lawrence. Come join the fun Filipino festivities. Even if we'll be away, we would still love if you celebrated AAPI Heritage Month with us by sharing Hainai with others who might be interested in our podcast, especially as Asian creators in the audio drama space. Anyway, now that I've gotten all that out of the way, enjoy the episode. You're listening to Hainai by Motsi Dapu. Episode 40. Pulong.
Anagolay, naway hayaan mong makita ng iyong alipin ang pananaw ng iyong mata. Nasaan po ako, Anagolay? Nasaan po ako? Sa ilalim ng lupa. I can't believe this is still running. I wonder, is anyone listening? Well, either way, if anything happens, I want to keep a record. In case... Let me start from the beginning.
Now, I can't trust you to not screw this up, but I can trust your power, which is why I am overlaying a glamour spell with a ventriloquy spell so that I know you're not running your mouth in front of all my fellows. Or worse, Richard Henry himself. And to do that, I'll be using your power to maintain it. Now give me your hand. Don't look at me like that. If I wanted you to fail, I would have just told Richard Henry of your existence and everything I know about you. Instead, I'm here assisting you. And if I'm found out, God knows what the benefactor will do to us.
Well, you're really afraid of him.
Of course I am. Did you miss the part where he absorbed the power of hundreds of terrified souls hurtling through to the other side? The part where he's clearly a psychopath who won't hesitate to burn down an entire city block if it means gaining power, but will literally behead any elder who overreaches.
Burning a... like... Savard?
Yes, like... Why are you looking at me like that?
Nothing.
Don't give me that. You're itching to say something smart, and I'm not in the headspace to trade barbs with the mystical wise woman. What do you know?
I don't think he's Savard.
And what do you know of Savard?
Didn't you say he disappeared, and the benefactor took his place? Why would he need to, if he already controlled you all? In fact, what made you so sure he was Savard in the first place?
I...
What? Is it because they both made you feel afraid? Or was there something else?
When Savard disappeared, I took some of his plans, his blueprints. It was my bargaining chip, and it was how I was able to make my arrangements with one of his inner circle. My now husband, Giuliano, was already powerful, and I knew that in a civil war, I was in danger of being wiped out if I didn't make a good ally. It was only after I was settled that I began to study his blueprints, and I realized exactly what he planned to do. He wanted to make a sort of god. One that would make the world better. Whatever that meant for a man like Savard. It would require an immense power source, far more than just the deaths of 1, 2, 5, 10 people. I didn't know he already built his machine until the benefactor showed it to me, back when we went to war with the puppet master. I didn't see it for decades after that, until you and your friends pointed me to the Gargantua. It clearly hadn't been used in a long time, perhaps even since the day the benefactor was empowered by all those souls escaping into the afterlife. So I fear he might have another one. Maybe he refined the process. I'm not sure if the benefactor truly is Savard, but it doesn't matter. He might as well be the same man. He wants what Savard wanted. He wields such impossible power. And knowing what Savard was capable of, I am afraid of what'll happen when he gets what he wants.
But you said that the benefactor already has that power. The fear and agony of hundreds of souls. With that power, he could have activated that machine long ago. So why didn't he?
Wants worse. Do you know that he asked to speak to me at the meeting? He said he wanted to speak to me in particular about my expertise.
But it won't be you he's speaking to.
No, I suppose not. But you understand my position? No matter what he wants, I can't tell him no. I'm not powerful enough for that.
Don't you have an insane power source in your back shed already?
How many nuclear guns have we as a species invented? Some things are too unstable to do more than contain. I already saw what it did to Giuliano, and I'm not sure if I should make the benefactor of all people aware of my experiment. All I use it for is to power the machine that contains it. Even now, only Giuliano can go inside it without dangerous consequences. And you, I suppose. Which I still want to know about, by the way.
Get us both through this meeting, and I'll tell you my secret.
All right. Here's the plan.
I used a, glamour to disguise myself as one of the elders. Vanessa Bartolotti. I knew about a meeting that was going down between the elders that allied with the benefactor, and I needed to infiltrate without detection. I'd gained prior knowledge of many of these elders, and used that to my advantage. The meeting was to take place in an old mansion close to Casa Loma, quiet now that the Halloween festivities were making way for their eventual Christmas fair. I was going into the meeting alone, but I wasn't stupid enough to try it without a backup, so my friends waited and listened from nearby, in case anything went down. When I arrived, there was present but sparse security, just enough to check our IDs at the door and allow us into the home. It was well lit, welcoming, even, and well catered, even if the staff serving the food was as sparse as the security. I was just surprised there was anyone else there at all, but the 2 to 4 people I saw, that I could tell were ordinary people hired for the event, seemed unfazed by what seemed to be just another meeting between rich eccentrics. The eccentrics in question, well, I was greeted by a few who spotted me, and from my mouth came Vanessa Bartolotti's voice. I used her knowledge, her mannerisms, while I tilted my head and smiled and laughed at all the places I thought were appropriate. I received cheek kisses from a woman all in red, who I last remember unhinging her jaw and swallowing human body parts whole. Minerva, my mind supplied. Minerva the cannibal. I shook gloved hands with a man whose bones I felt squeezing under my fingertips, and in my head, a voice spoke the name Martin. Martin Knowles, with his hand that he used to hold an ancient artifact, unearthed in the long winter, thinking that elder magic was enough to keep him safe. Still better off than what happened to Giuliano, but unwise, nonetheless. His hand, he'd once said, had died, even if the rest of him remained. A pale woman smiled at me, her canines sharper than the rest of her teeth, sipping from a glass full of red that looked too thick to be wine. Her name was Claudia, and she was so charmed that a self-styled vampire hunter once buried her alive that she decided to get into blood drinking. "Keeps me young," she claimed, laughing behind a hand as smooth and pale as ivory. A shaking man bumped into me as I moved through the crowd, his eyes uncomfortably wide as he shook my hand in greeting, and I saw that his hands were covered in markings, scars making up numbers, letters, symbols, written over each other over years of mutilation that had somehow not healed. "Are you all right, Manfred?" I'd asked, reaching out, and he laughed in a way that sounded like a sob, walking away before I could get an answer. "Don't mind him," said another, and I turned to see a man with dark round glasses, smiling at me with bright white teeth. "He thinks his apprentice means to kill him, and take his place. Take all the foci meant for him, take the life force meant for him, and all that. Like what Martin did, even if the lad didn't mean to do it. The magic of the land is too unpredictable. I don't even know if his apprentice can replicate it. In between you and me, he'd do our faction some good. Manfred has always been dead weight." When he leaned down to kiss my hand, I saw above his glasses, into the empty sockets, both his eyes and part of his eyelids missing. "I'm sure you're right," I said. Vincent LaBelle tipped his absent hat, left at the door, no doubt, and went on to greet the others. Nobody seemed to notice that I was not Vanessa. The glamour held strong, and in some ways, acted as a barrier between me and the vomit-inducing elder energies that surrounded me. I guess the constant, mild look of disgust on my face just sold the illusion. I didn't know who owned the place, but I did see things that I recognized from stories I heard, or read from the book. Little marionettes, sitting on a mantle, posed to give an illusion of life. A statue of a Greek figure, missing its head. A mirror that invited me to come close, with strange shapes hiding just behind my body. A few old photos of individuals and families I knew to be elders who had long since passed, killed by the benefactor himself, or by their own hubris. Grigori, Cecil, Roland, Arkan, Elman. Clarence Thompson, who I'd met as the Cold Ghost, standing with a hand on his wife's shoulder while she held their infant daughter. Jean-Paul Renard, George May's old lover, laughing as he reclined on a couch surrounded by foliage. I had the impression that they were there as both memorial and warning, like a reminder of those who crossed the line, the thing that everyone here feared the benefactor for. Everything I'd read of him painted a clearer picture than the blind fear I learned from the elders we encountered over the past few months. He was as much their warden as their leader, acted against them when they stepped out of line. And yet, the foci still existed, still terrorized and killed people. And from what I learned from Donner, more so in the past few years than the last few comparatively quiet decades. And the benefactor, for all his power, did nothing to stop it. Eventually, we were called to dinner, led to what looked to be a ballroom, but with a stage in the middle for someone to stand up and perform. Like a jazz club, with its dark velvet curtains and old microphone in the center aisle. I was sat beside Vincent, the young Martin, and Patience Glass, the most ordinary of accountants, who had since lived in the UK after the war with a puppet master, and ingratiated herself with certain members of nobility there. I had a good enough angle to see where eyes went when conversation suddenly hushed, and I saw an unfamiliar man walk up the stage. I didn't notice that my grip had tightened on my glass until Vincent spoke to me, asking about my meeting with the man from months back. "Went well, I take it," he asked, and I sipped my drink instead of answering. Up on stage stood Richard Henry, his fine cufflinks glinting in the light. When he spoke, everyone fell silent. "Friends and compatriots, I'm afraid that our leader is unable to attend tonight," he said, in his strangely gentle, strangely kindly voice. "But he wanted you all to eat and be merry, in preparation for this coming long winter, a harsh one by all accounts. The land has become even more unpredictable, and we all know from our time under our founder, Savard, may the powers bless his soul, our magic will manifest differently. It may become more erratic, more uncontrollable, as the fear of the dark winter grips the country, or perhaps grow weaker, nigh unusable. Make your preparations, that we may not be vulnerable in this time, against attacks.
Attacks?
One of those in attendance chimed in.
How many enemies do we even still have that have not pledged allegiance to our dear benefactor? How many has he not already killed?
Vernon, if you aren't already aware of new threats that have hounded some of our fellows, then you need not be prepared, and have the wolf at your door before long, said Richard Henry, nothing but pleasant in tone. Natural users, not one, but two, have interrupted so many of our foci already, so that we are not receiving new life, new magic. George Langford nearly returned, all three of his foci activating just this year. There was risk of the same for Thompson. A disturbance, an interruption, facilitated by these new natural users, trying to find us and ours, and stop us. Kill us. We even got word that they tried to work with Langford. How long before a real threat was resurrected from the foci, holding pieces of our benefactor's old enemies? Grigory, Renard, Roland, even perhaps the Puppet Master. That sent a murmur through the crowd, whispers of how that was impossible, questions of whether it truly was. And what does our benevolent leader mean to do about this? Asked Glass, clipped tones cutting through the noise. He has a way to ensure that we, all of us, have a nigh endless supply of power, like the magic from the earth that has eluded us for so long, said Richard Henry, and that set them all off once again. The plan is already in motion. All you need to do is be patient and live through this winter. That is the message he wanted me to deliver. If you have any more questions, you may relay them to me. After dinner. Now, enjoy your meal. The promise Richard Henry made on the benefactor's behalf sat with me throughout dinner. The food was delicious, but I couldn't really enjoy it, not in the presence of so much sickly power. It made me antsy, kept me on edge, and the only thing that comforted me was knowing that my friends were standing by, ready to assist me the moment I needed out. When all was said and done, everyone seemed eager to speak to Richard Henry, one-on-one. But it was my privilege, rather, Vanessa's privilege, to meet him first, on the benefactor's behalf. The room I entered was aged, yet pristine, well-preserved. There were many things behind glass that I recognized as foci, when I brushed my fingers against the surface, some defunct, and some still active. Richard Henry was nothing but gracious, offering to pour me a drink while standing by the fireplace. He'd lost his jacket, almost casual if not for the high collar of his shirt and the cufflinks still sealing his sleeves. I sat, nervous as I imagined Vanessa would be, as Richard Henry poured himself a drink and spoke. "Did you really think we wouldn't notice?" he said, conversationally. But already, the words put me on edge. "The thing that you have behind your house." My racing heart calmed. No, he didn't know it was me. Still, Vanessa would be terrified, even without her there. It sounded like the sort of thing she was trying to keep secret, even from her fellow elders.
"Don't worry,"
said Richard Henry, tone comforting and cool.
"You're not in trouble.
He's really quite pleased. How did you manage it, by the way? Tearing through the veil. I don't understand it much myself, but the benefactor... He... Well, I think you remember that day. The souls, the windows into the other side. You know, when Juliano stopped coming to these meetings, the benefactor was too curious to leave it be. But only this year did he discover your little project. You hit it well. Congratulations. He's pleased, I said, voice shaking just a little. Vanessa's fear in mine. Well, of course. Your little accident aligns perfectly with his plans. To share power, I said, with everyone. An endless supply. What did he mean by that? Magic has always been a finite resource for us. It's why so many of us have killed each other over it. So what has he discovered? I'm not at liberty to say at this time, said Richard Henry, infuriatingly gentle. I wanted to press, but I wasn't quite sure how. And as I pondered my next move, Richard Henry emptied his glass. And instead of standing up to get another finger for his drink, he cast a spell, and an all-too-familiar red hand floated out to do his work for him. A red hand that I'd last seen on Halloween, above the vicious, murderous monster that was Laurie of Hyde. I don't know what came over me then. Rage, of course. Terror. I could see it so clearly. Abe's eyes widened in terror as he died in my arms. Laurie's laughter, dancing like a little ballerina as, one by one, she killed the people I meant to protect, the red hand above her all the while, pulling her strings like a puppet's. Not quite controlling her actions, but keeping her upright and animate. I stood at full height. Not very much of it. Vanessa wasn't much taller than I was. And that seemed to startle Richard Henry. I knew I was compromising myself, but I didn't care. I couldn't care. Not in that moment. And though I only stood at a certain height, I knew that the fireplace cast my shadow as it was. Longer and longer, filling the room with a figure far more imposing than the woman who stood there. I think he saw something in me. I think he saw something in my eyes. Because Richard Henry said nothing more as he threw a silent, destructive spell at me that did nothing to me but shattered the glass and blasted wood around and behind me. He saw that and saw my shadow and my eyes. No longer Vanessa's eyes, but mine. And he ran.
So, you're awake.
Hi. Cornelius. Or should I call you something else?
You've done your research then. Got your hands on his book. Poor lad. Stuck his nose where it didn't belong, too. But you seem to be faring better than he ever did.
I know who you are, and I know what you've done. William Cornelius Savard.
All my crimes reflected in those eyes. So, now that you know who I am, what say you?
You are not the benefactor. I know that for a fact. And tonight, we both went after his right hand. So tell me, can we be allies in this? Or should I count you as another enemy?
You're listening to Hainai by Motsi Dapul.
Hey everyone, it's Motsi. Currently, protests are still ongoing, calling for the divestment of companies and institutions that profit from Israeli apartheid, genocide, and occupation in Palestine. These protests have been met with violent retaliation from pro-Israel groups, as well as police intervention, across various universities in which protests are occurring. More horrifically, a second of two mass graves has been discovered at the Nasser Hospital, the first of which was discovered at the Al-Shifa Hospital in southern Gaza. The bodies show indications of field executions, with most of them having their hands tied behind their backs. There is even suspicion that some of them were buried alive, and show signs of torture. Many of these bodies were that of children. Despite this, the U.S. continues to provide billions of dollars in aid and weapons to the Israeli military. The situation is untenable, and has been from the beginning. Multiple countries have cut diplomatic ties with Israel over its actions in Gaza. The latest being the country of Colombia and Turkey. Several other countries, including South Africa, Bahrain, Chile, Honduras, Chad, and Jordan, have withdrawn and recalled their ambassadors. In particular, Colombia's President Gustavo Petro has denounced Israel's actions as a genocide. While things remain grim, recently aid has entered through North Gaza for the first time since October, and groups such as World Central Kitchen have resumed their humanitarian work in Gaza. All is not hopeless. Aid is reaching Palestinians, news of the protests is reaching Palestinians, and many Palestinians, especially children, are grateful to the students who are calling for divestment from Israel and a free Palestine. Please continue to support humanitarian efforts, as well as the protesters who are putting their lives and bodies on the line for the sake of Palestinian freedom and safety. As usual, I've linked relevant aid resources in the description of this episode. Never lose hope, take care of each other, and as always, Kalayaan para sa Palestina. Ingat.
Crimes of the Marcoses. Student activism played a key role in the downfall of the Marcos regime. Students were at the forefront of protest movements with varying political orientations, collectively becoming one of the most active elements in the political scene. In the years 1970 and 1971 alone, before martial law had even begun, student activists participated in 214 demonstrations and 39 class boycotts, and, as reported in the Manila Times, issued 72 statements. They joined forces and established coalitions with reformists and radical factions of working classes, and even participated in 76 demonstrations alongside farmers and workers. In 1971, students of the University of the Philippines, with the support of academic and non-academic personnel, formed the famous Diliman Commune. It was a 9-day uprising which began in support of transport workers against the oil price hikes, and then transformed into a movement against military force on campus. Barricades were put in place that blocked all traffic and all military authority from entering, students took over the radio stations and the UP press. When martial law was declared, the crackdown on activism was intensified. However, this did not deter the student spirits, who brought the fight underground. They continued to circulate press that spoke against the martial law propaganda. Thousands were arrested during this era under suspicion of rebellion. Students comprised the largest number of detainees, many being identified with radical National Democratic organizations. Their bravery did not come without cost. Many of these student activists lost their lives. Archimedes Trajano, Liliosa Hilao, Modesto Bong Sison, Manuel Bautista, Antero Santos. These are just a few of the names among those killed. Today, students continue the fight against injustice, inside and outside the Philippines. For the jeepney drivers of Manila, for the people of Gaza, the youth have always been a driving force of change, choosing to leave the comforts of their classroom to bring about the future our ancestors fought for. Today, we remember their sacrifices and bravery, not only throughout history, but also in the present.
Hey everyone, this is Reg Helly, co-creator and co-producer of Hainai. Hainai is a podcast produced by Motsi Dapol, Yoyi Halago, Alisa Jimenez, and me, and licensed under Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Sharealike 4.0 International License. This episode was co-produced by Jesse Goodsell, and written and directed by Motsi Dapol, who also plays the role of Mary Datuin. The role of Vanessa was played by Maya Dapol, and the role of Cornelius was played by Ivan Dapol. If you'd like to chat with other listeners when this episode goes live, we do a live premiere every other Sunday at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time or Toronto Time on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/HainaiPod. To help support the production of Hainai, you can subscribe to our Patreon at patreon.com/HainaiPod. You'll get to be a part of our early access program where we release episodes 3 days earlier on Thursdays at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. You can also get bonus video, audio, art, and so much more. Speaking of Patreon, we'd love to give a shout out to the following patrons for all their amazing support. Tanya Grzynski, Diana Cos, B. Stafford, Jaden, Jesse Kagape, Cyan Daisy, Madeline Hicks, Melissa, Emily Halig, Faye Fungi, Cloudy Creates, Eileen Meek, Pablo Neurotic, Teresa Liu, K.D. Hart, Evie Smith, Megan, Nick Templo Perez, Robert Collins, Jesse Goodsell, Yordanos Belete, Disc Monde, Rebecca Mad Gastronomer, Robbie, Malaya Light, Rhea, Nicole, Victoria Goodwin, and Billy Atienza. If you can't subscribe monthly, you also have the option to buy us a milk tea on Ko-fi at ko-fi.com/HainaiPod. That's ko-fi.com/HainaiPod. Our ad-free Hainai album, which has our official music and full episodes from Act 1 and 2, is also available in both Patreon and the Ko-fi store. Check out our website, hainaipod.com, for more information, and for more news and updates, don't forget to follow us on our blog, hainaipod.tumblr.com, as well as our socials on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at HainaiPod. That's HINAYPOD. Hainai is available on Acast and wherever you listen to podcasts. We hope you enjoy our Act 3 episodes, and as always, thank you, we love you, and hanggang sa muli.